I think most of you know Ali, who's an educator at the School of Physiotherapy here in Christchurch. So Ali's presenting on a study that we did, which seems many moons ago. I can remember that it was 2011, because we are presenting on a study that was part of the Skipper Forearm project, and I remember this because we were in week two of our first Skipper round, and we had a small disruption by an earthquake. Ali's going to talk to you about that project. So,
lovely. Oh, well, it's great to be here today to finally be able to present this this work to you. So as Jo said, it was a study that we carried out alongside the Skipper RCT, and we had a group of four final year physiotherapy students who worked on this project, and they were Dawa Ahmed Ali, Gemma Kensington, Tim McVicker and Olivia Van Schack, and it was supervised by Jo, Dr. Hilda Mulligan, who is one of my colleagues at the School of Physiotherapy, and she's unable to be here today, which is she regrets, but I was also part of the supervising team as well. And it's quite an exciting study to do, really, because we know that people with spinal cord injury do not have very high levels of physical activity, and that they face barriers to access for physical activity. So it was exciting to hear what they've got to say. So in terms of what we know about the RCT, we know that RCTs are considered the gold standard method to assess the efficacy of treatment and to minimise bias when evaluating health interventions. But what we very little is known about the reasons why people participate in RCTs and their experiences of doing so. So that was the purpose of this qualitative study, to describe the experiences of persons with spinal cord injury who were participating in the Skipper full-on RCT. So we didn't set out to evaluate Skipper though, we just wanted to figure out what their experiences were for being a part of that project. And it was certainly a really exciting opportunity for our physiotherapy students to be able to learn about the practicalities of being involved in randomised controlled trials, which doesn't happen, come along very frequently. So just to set the scene of what full-on entailed, Australian and New Zealand sites were invited to participate in full-on by the principal investigator, Professor Mary Galea from the University of Melbourne. And so Skipper compared the effects of an intensive activity-based program consisting of bodyweight support, treadmill training, FES bike and core strengthening, and that was the experimental group, in comparison with an upper limb and fitness training program for the control group. So irrespective of their allocation to the randomisation, they engaged in the intervention three times a week for 12 weeks. The experimental group was, program was delivered by a team of physiotherapists and research assistants, whereas the control group exercise program was supervised by a fitness instructor. So during the 12 weeks of intervention, the participants were unable to engage in any other therapy, which included alternative therapies or take medications, including herbal preparations that were not considered part of standard care, and that was documented in the study protocol. Okay, so only the first two groups of the New Zealand full-on participants were invited to take part in this qualitative study, and that was because the physio students have a very short time frame in which to complete their research projects of 6 weeks, so we just had to run with whoever was around and invite everybody that could. So we ended up with 8 individuals with spinal cord injury, 3 males and 5 females between the ages of 23 to 69. 5 of the participants were allocated to the experimental group and 3 to the control. 3 participants were classified as AISA, 1 AISB and 4 AISD. And so the participants engaged in video diary interviews in a private room with no one else present, unless they needed support to start and stop the recording. Okay, so they were asked to answer a set of 4 questions, and they did this at the beginning, around the middle, and at the end of the 3 months of intervention. And we asked them how the program had been so far, what were their expectations of the program, what they thought the highs and lows of the program were, and we also let them post any other message that they wanted to the organisers of the program. So we transcribed each video diary verbatim and analysed the data inductively using an approach described by Attride Sterling, which is what you see here on this diagram. And it's an approach where you code the data and organise it and organise the codes into categories, and then they go into thematic networks. And there's 3 levels of thematic networks, so you get basic themes, organising themes, and global themes. And then in this study we found 3 distinct and independent organising themes, and they were accompanied by a series of basic themes, as I'll show you along the way. So the 3 themes were the excitement of opportunity to participate in the trial, personal rewards for participation, and also the frustrations to participation that the participants experience. Okay, so the participants in both groups appreciated the opportunity to participate in full-on. Participants, particularly in the experimental group, were excited to be presented with an opportunity to participate in an intervention that they saw as a new and innovative approach, which was quite different to their usual management. And these participants were highly motivated to participate as they felt that the intervention aligned directly with their personal aspirations, which often included walking. And as participant 2 says, "Yeah, I'm definitely seeing improvement, which is amazing, and I just want to keep going and see how far I can go. Well, how far my body can go." Participants in the control group were motivated to engage in the intervention to optimise and maximise their physical functional capacity. Even though they knew that it wasn't a new approach, they did understand that they were going to have access to engage in much higher levels of physical activity during full-on than they usually did. And in addition to pursuing their personal goals, the participants expressed a sense of responsibility that the results of the study could enhance future rehabilitation for people with spinal cord injury. And participant 6 says, "To provide some information for researchers to utilise it in the future and help with spinal cord injury rehabilitation and treatment long term. So that was one reason for me to be involved. I wanted to feel that I could be a part of that." So the participants also talked about their personal rewards for being part of full-on. In both groups, participants described the benefits for their functional independence and their activities of daily living, and they felt that they could do their ADLs with much less effort. They were excited about the physical benefits of increased cardiovascular fitness, endurance, respiratory function, balance and upper limb strength, along with decreased muscle spasm and weight loss. And participant 3, "I expected to improve my cardiovascular fitness and, you know, general strength, and I have." And participant 5 was excited because they'd already dropped a size in trousers. Interestingly, the control group perceived their improvements to be at the impairment level at the beginning of full-on, but by the end of the program, their thoughts had shifted towards seeing them more as functional gains. The experimental group, they recognised that the treadmill training directly translated to functional improvements in overground walking. And as full-on progressed, participants in both groups described improvements to body image and general well-being. Both groups of participants felt they gained confidence in self-management of their condition, and they became empowered to take control over their lives. They shared how full-on had been a journey of self-discovery, a chance to learn about themselves, their abilities and their limitations, particularly when they saw themselves achieve physical gains that they never thought possible. So participant two, I'm excited that I can actually do a lot more than I thought I could do, and that's been really exciting for me. The majority of participants were inspired and motivated to continue with their physical activity after full-on had finished. They saw that the gains that they made during full-on, and they recognised that they were responsible personally for their long-term management if they wanted to continue enjoying the benefits from full-on. The participants in both groups highlighted the hope that full-on would remove physical, social and societal barriers to physical activity and create a sense of community. Some participants felt safe to exercise and push their boundaries, knowing that they had health professional supervision. And members of the control group also talked about how they felt part of a team, describing an atmosphere that was free from judgment and discrimination, which allowed them to feel much more included and accepted. And participant six. It's a very non-threatening environment to be in. I found that really good. You feel like you're part of a team, working towards providing some results. A positive thing. Okay. So alongside these personal rewards for participating in full-on, participants also describe some frustrating aspects. Participants randomised to the control group were disappointed, perceiving a potential loss of an opportunity for personal gain. So as participant three says, one of the lows was probably being randomised into the control group. Having some lower limb function, I was keen to give the treatment group a try to see what improvement I could gain. Both groups of participants were concerned about the lack of individualisation of the intervention. So the participants in the experimental group were frustrated at the slow treadmill speed, and the participants in the control group were frustrated that the exercises couldn't be tailored to match their own ability. And as participant three says, one thing I'm not enjoying is trying to do exercises that I'm not able to do. There were also equipment glitches reported by members of the experimental group with the treadmill malfunctioning or incorrect setup. One participant talked specifically about some very uncomfortable pinching of the harness. The participants, they also experienced side effects of the increased amount of physical activity during full-on, and they reported headaches, muscle tightness and post-exercise pain. And to let you know that they were all managed in accordance to the full-on protocol. The participants also discussed personal costs and sacrifices of being involved in full-on. So participant six, coming from out of town, I had to make a decision as to whether to come down for 3 months anyway, despite what group I got into. I had to be sure I wasn't going to be disappointed long-term. Some participants were frustrated that they couldn't continue their usual therapies, exercise or sporting activities. Initially, they worried that they might lose functional ability or fitness that they'd had prior to participation in full-on, and they perceived if that happened that would have frustrating consequences for them. The control group participants hoped that there would be sufficient benefit to outweigh the personal sacrifices they felt they made to full-on. And participants were frustrated at how time-consuming full-on was, which limited their involvement in other life activities. And one participant talked about having to get up much earlier at 5 o'clock in the morning so she could do her work and get to full-on and try and manage her day. And they were also uncertain if they would be able to continue to access the specialist equipment and the support after the trial had finished. So just to acknowledge some limitations of our study, due to the very short time frame in which we had to carry out the study, we were unable to use a maximum variation sampling strategy, which is recommended for qualitative descriptive studies. And the flow-on effect from that was we did have insufficient data to support a global theme. And ideally, recruiting from both Australia and New Zealand sites would have been perfect. The other thing was that using the video diaries meant that we couldn't engage with the participants like you would in a normal semi-structured or open-ended interview. So we couldn't stimulate any discussion beyond the set questions. So it's a kind of a double-edged sword, because if you don't do that, which we didn't, this meant that we gained very accurate and authentic data without our researcher bias. So yeah, swings and roundabouts. So anyway, in saying that, what we've learned is that full-on did provide a safe way to challenge the participants' physical and psychological boundaries, which benefits overall health and well-being. And we also had a few take-home messages for future researchers of clinical trials. And we felt that we needed to think about how participants can continue self-managing their physical activity after the trial has finished. Because full-on did show that participants need access to the equipment, and they also need a supportive network so that they can enhance their self-efficacy and self-management. We also need to consider barriers to participation in the planning phase of a clinical trial, and particularly to highlight the personal costs to the people who are going to participate in the study. And secondly, to figure out a way of how to enhance trial outcomes for the participants, and particularly around individualising the intervention within each group for the participants. So, just before I finish, I'd just like to acknowledge our participants. They're great. And Professor Mary Galea and the Skipper Research Group, and to Jo for all of her organising, which was fantastic as well. So thank you, and we'll open the floor for some questions.
Did you work with people, were they in a group, or you worked with each person individually? I mean, were they all there together, the participants, in the Skipper?
So for the control group,
they were a group
in the Parafed gym, and they worked on their exercises, either individuals or different apparatus, and then coming back to do some sort of more cardiovascular work. And for Skipper, there were three.